Hey guys, I'm Andrew here, and today's video we will be celebrating Disney Centennial. Just kidding, there's nothing for Disney to celebrate about, for this year at least. So unless you have been living under a rock, then you probably have heard that Disney's having a rough year. Like, a really rough year. So bad, in fact, that Disney CEO Bob Iger is no longer able to hide it.
There have been some disappointments. We would have liked some of our more recent releases to have performed better.
More on that interview later. All empires eventually collapse under their own weight, and Disney is not exempt. Even the media juggernaut that is the House of Mouse is not too big to fail. But how did things get this bad? It seemed like they were killing it just a couple years ago, right? And they were. However, problematic signs have been there for a while. Cracks in the foundation that many people wouldn't have noticed if they weren't looking closely. Perhaps a magnifying glass would have helped.
Oh, it does follow, Brian, because I'm the one with the giant magnifying glass. Is my eye big?
Yeah.
Good. Good. That means progress.
The video will be broken into three parts. The history of the company, what's going on this year and how we got here, and what the future is possibly going to look like. I will be going in chronological order, and I will be starting from the very beginning. It seemed fitting to recap Disney's 100-year history for its centenary. While I won't be celebrating its centenary outright like many Disnoids probably did, I will be honoring it in a way by going through some of the highs and lows of the company's rich history. I originally intended all three parts to be in one video, but due to time constraints and life getting in the way, I wasn't able to finish the whole video in time for the end of Disney's centenary. But don't you worry, I will get parts 2 and 3 uploaded in a follow-up video in the near future. So if I stated that I would come back to a point later, and didn't, in this video, don't worry, I'll be following up on it in a sequel video. So make sure to subscribe so you can catch parts 2 and 3 in the second half of what was supposed to be one big mega video. Alright then, without further ado, let's go back in time to the humble beginnings of this media giant. Part 1, Chapter 1, Dreams and Aspirations. The Walt Disney Company started with the dreams and aspirations of one man who loved the draw. Walt Elias Disney was born December 5th, 1901, in Chicago, Illinois. He took art classes as a boy and was hired for an illustrator job at 18. In 1921, Walt Disney and fellow animator Ub Iwerks founded Laugh-O-Graph Studios in Kansas City, Missouri. The two would create several short films before the company went bankrupt. The final short film created was Alice's Wonderland, starring child actress Virginia Davids, interacting with animated characters. This failure, however, wouldn't hold Walt Disney down, because the same year this company went bankrupt, Walt joined his brother, Roy Oliver Disney, in California to form a little company known as Disney Brothers Studio in 1923. Alice's Wonderland was not made in vain, however, due to Disney's determination. Walt contacted New York film distributor Margaret J. Winkler, who then decided to purchase it. She liked it so much that she signed a contract to Disney for $1,500, which would be over $25,000 today. Walt would have to produce 6 series of Alice comedies with an option for 2 more 6-episode series. Over the next few years, several Alice films would be made by the Disney Brothers Studio, and they were distributed by Margaret Winkler's husband, Charles Mintz. In 1926, Disney Brothers Studio name would be changed to Walt Disney Studio. I wonder how Roy felt about that. I bet many of you didn't even know Walt Disney had a brother until watching this video. Though Walt Disney was a creative genius and the face of the company, Roy was the business mind. Walt had big dreams, and Roy helped them come true.
And after all, a dream is a wish your heart made.
Part 1, Chapter 2, The Unlucky Lucky Rabbit. In 1927, a historic request was made. Charles Mintz asked the Disney Brothers for a new series to be made. This would lead to Walt Disney creating his first completely animated series, starring a character named Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. Diehard Disney fans and epic Mickey enjoyers are sure to recognize this fun little character. It has been so long since his inception that he's now public domain. More on that topic later in the video. Walt Disney Studios will complete 26 Oswald shorts in total. While Walt Disney had his ups and downs, 1928 would prove to be the most volatile year of his career. Walt wanted more money for his films, but Mintz wanted to pay Walt even less. Bad news would continue when Walt discovered that his precious creation, Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, didn't belong to him. Universal Pictures owned the intellectual property rights of Oswald. Mintz threatened Walt to produce the films for a lower payment, or he would make the films without him. Walt refused Mintz's terms, so Mintz signed on all but one of Disney's primary animators, Bob Iwerks being the only one to stay with the Disney brothers. While the future may have not seemed bright for Walt at the moment, this would end up being the best thing to ever happen to him, as the loss of Oswald and the lessons learned from the situation would lead to Disney's ultimate creation. Walt was also really lucky that Bob Iwerks decided to stay with him, because he would be integral to the success of Walt and Roy's company. Perhaps there was some luck to that rabbit after all. But not in his feet, right, Bugs?
What's up, Doc?
Sorry, Mac. Me luck's run out, and I gotta have a good luck charm, and you're it.
Now, wait a minute, Doc. Let's not be hasty. Rabbit's feet ain't lucky.
No?
Nah, look at the life rabbits lead. Dogs, hunters, horse and fiffers. These rabbit's feet never brought me any luck.
Part 1, Chapter 3, A Most Magnificent Mouse. Walt and Iwerks would replace Oswald with a mouse character that would go on to become one of the most famous intellectual properties of all time. That's right, it's the iconic Mortimer Mouse. Mortimer Mouse, what? Which is the name they were originally going to go with. Luckily that name didn't stick, because that is a terrible name. Mortimer Mouse's clubhouse just doesn't have the same ring to it now, does it? Walt's wife Lillian Disney urged him to change the name to the name she had in mind, Mickey Mouse. And thankfully he listened, because I can't imagine a world in which the face of Disney was Mortimer Mouse. Well, maybe now, because Disney is a shell of his former self. But we'll get into that in the second part of the video. They would create two silent shorts, Plain Crazy and The Galloping Gaucho, to test out their new character. Later in the year, the studio released its third Mickey short, which was their first sound film, the iconic Steamboat Willie. They made the film using synchronized sound, becoming the first post-produced sound cartoon. The Pat Powers Distribution Company distributed Steamboat Willie, and it was an immediate success. They would re-release the two earlier shorts, Plain Crazy and The Galloping Gaucho, with synchronized sound the following year in 1929. In August of 29, Walt Disney began making the Silly Symphonies with Columbia Pictures. Silly Symphonies did not typically feature recurring characters, and was mainly focused on making whimsical animations that complemented the music. On July 24, 1930, the president of King Features Syndicate wrote to Disney Studios and requested the company to produce a Mickey Mouse comic strip. The Mickey Mouse comic strip would go on to be published in 60 newspapers across the United States by 1931. In December of 1930, the Walt Disney Studios partnership was reorganized as a corporation titled Walt Disney Productions, which featured a merchandising division called Disney Enterprises and subsidiary companies named the Disney Film Recording Company and Lilied Realty and Investment Company. At the time, 60% of the company was owned by Walt and his wife Lillian, and the other 40% was owned by Roy. The investment subsidiary managed many real estate holdings, owning large swaths of property, which would become a staple for the company, as Disney practically owns half of Orlando. Surprise gator meat ain't on the menu at the parks yet.
Florida hunting guide says his team caught what could be the second heaviest alligator ever harvested in the state.
Look at this thing behind us. It's creeping me out. Okay, last Friday, they got an alligator that was 920 pounds. As West 2's Marlene Martinez tells us, they found it in a lake in Orlando.
Part 1, Chapter 4, Merchandising the Mouse. A New York businessman offered Walt Disney $300, which would be worth about $5,000 today, to license the character of Mickey Mouse, as he wanted to put him on his writing tablets that he was manufacturing. Walt accepted the deal, and Mickey Mouse became the first licensed character. In 1933, Walt Disney reached out to Kay Kamen, the owner of a Kansas City advertising firm, to run Disney's merchandising division. Kamen agreed and transformed Disney's merchandising division seemingly overnight. Within a year of the role, Kamen had 40 licensed Mickey Mouse products. By his second year in the role, he had made $35 million worth of sales. In 1934, Disney was making more money off its merchandising than its films. The merchandising effects of the mouse were so impactful that it saved some companies from bankruptcy during the Great Depression, such as the Waterbury Clock Company, whose Mickey Mouse watch was so popular that it single-handedly kept the lights on the company, selling over 2.5 million Mickey Mouse watches in the span of 2 years. That's a lot of money.
Good morning, my darlings. You're coming home with me.
Part 1, Chapter 5, Dawn of the Duck. Mickey Mouse evolved from a more mischievous character to a more heroic character, so Disney needed a different character they could use for gags. Donald Duck was the character they came up with to fill that role, making his first appearance in 1934 in the short The Wise Little Hen. Donald would be voiced by the iconic Clarence Nash, who would be forever remembered as the voice of Donald Duck.
Hi, everybody. I'm Clarence Nash, and I'm the voice of Donald Duck.
Yeah, hello, everybody.
While not as initially popular as Mickey Mouse, his popularity would grow over time, and he would eventually get his own series. He would become a fan favorite for many, including myself, as Donald has always been my favorite of the Mickey Mouse crew.
He's been blowing his stack at the drop of a hat.
Part 1, Chapter 6, Walt's first feature film. 1934 was the year where Walt decided to make his first feature film. The film would be Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, based on a German fairy tale written by the Brothers Grimm. The film was the first of many of the Grimm Brothers' works to be adapted by Disney. Many were pessimistic about the film's chances. Roy Disney tried to stop Walt from making the movie, stating that it would likely bankrupt the company. The film was known in Hollywood as Disney's Folly, but none of the cynicism stopped Walt from making the movie. He created a realistic approach to the animation instead of the wild and over-the-top movements cartoons were known for at the time. He had the characters move as if they were live actors. The company created the multiplane camera to use on the film. It was a piece of glass upon which drawings were placed at different distances to create the illusion of depth to the image. Walt Disney went way over his budget for the film. The initial budget was $150,000, and they ended up spending a whopping $1.5 million, which would be worth about $33 million today. While that seems dirt cheap for a Hollywood movie made today, it was a much bigger price tag at the time. Walt's first film would cost well over three times the typical price of a big-budget film of that era. The film would be distributed by RKO Radio Pictures and it would take 3 years to make. The film would debut on December 12, 1937, and it would prove all the doubters wrong. Walt's first feature film made $8 million, becoming the highest-grossing film of all time up to that point.
Hi-ho, hi-ho, it's home from work we go. Hi-ho.
$8 million back then would be worth approximately $162 million today. Walt would use those profits to construct a new studio complex that would take up 51 acres in Burbank, California. By 1940, the company had fully moved into the new complex. 51 acres will definitely keep you from feeling cramped. Not a luxury everyone can afford. Right, New Yorkers?
Hey, let's check out the rest of the place. I think this is it.
Part 1, Chapter 7, Walt's first flop. While Snow White would go on to break records, his second feature film would not fare as well. His second film was Pinocchio, which released on February 7, 1940. While Pinocchio would be critically acclaimed, winning two Academy Awards, one for Best Music Original Score and the other for Best Music Original Song. The song was When You Wish Upon a Star.
When you wish upon a star, your dreams come true.
It unfortunately was also a commercial failure, largely due to no fault of its own. The onset of World War II cut off European and Asian markets. While it's tough to go from breaking records to flopping, things would not always be so glum for Pinocchio. The movie would make money on its re-release in 1945 and would go down as one of the best movies ever made in the eyes of critics and general audiences alike. Not too shabby for an initial flop.
Not too shabby.
Part 1, Chapter 8, Going Public. On April 2nd, 1940, Disney had its initial public offering. Walt didn't want to go public, but he needed the money in order for the company to keep growing. He put the needs of the company before his own desires. Good on you, Walt.
Good job.
Part 1, Chapter 9, Another Fantastical Flop. The next feature film to be released by the Disney company was Fantasia. This film was designed as a comeback for Mickey, as the character's popularity had been waning.
Thank you.
was regarded as a fan favorite today, it did not do well commercially upon release, largely due to the same reasons as Pinocchio's commercial failings. However, also like Pinocchio, it would be re-released. Fantasia, when adjusted for inflation, is the 23rd highest grossing movie of all time. Good for you, Mick.
Good job!
Part 1, Chapter 10, The Animator's Strike Back. Walt Disney's woes in the 40s continued as major animator strike organized by top animator Art Babbitt, who was credited with developing the character of Goofy, led the strike, which lasted for several weeks. This was a major setback for the company, as 300 of the 800 animators refused to work until their demands were met. Walt thought that many of the strikers were secretly communists, and he fired several of the studio's animators, which included some of his top talent. During this time, Roy tried to secure more production funds from distributors as the company couldn't afford to offset production costs with the employee layoffs. He was unsuccessful in this endeavor. Disney's fourth film would suffer harassment from the striking animators. The film titled The Reluctant Dragon was picketed by the striking animators upon release. They accused the company of unfair business practices, low pay, lack of recognition, and favoritism. At one theater, the picketers showed up with a dragon bearing a sign that said, The Reluctant Disney. Federal mediators stepped in as a result of the strike, and Disney had to recognize the Screen Cartoonists Guild. By the time the strike was over, there were 694 animators left working at the company. Strikes would become commonplace in the entertainment industry. In fact, we had two just this year.
We'll not be having our jobs taken away and giving to robots. We will not allow you to take away our dignity.
Part 1, Chapter 11, The Elephant That Could. The fifth feature film to be released by Disney was Dumbo. Dumbo was made with a sole purpose in mind, to make some quick cash. They needed to recover from the last few films underperforming, so they made a short feature film that clocked in at only 64 minutes. The film debuted on October 23, 1941. Dumbo was a fairly simple yet endearing story about a misfit circus elephant who used what he perceived as his biggest flaw and turned it into his greatest strength. It's a heartwarming film full of laughs. Fortunately for Disney, the film would turn a profit. I loved Dumbo as a kid, but it also kind of creeped me out, due to one particular scene. We all know what scene I'm talking about. You're lying to yourself if pink elephants on parade didn't disturb you a little bit as a child. That shit was borderline nightmare fuel.
Look out! Look out! Pink elephants on parade! Here they come! Hippity-hoppity! They're here! And there are pink elephants everywhere! Look out! Look out! They're walking around the bed, on their head, clippity-cloppity, parade, in braid, pink elephants on parade.
What'll I do? What'll I do? What an unusual view.
I can stand the sight of worms and look at microscopic germs, but technicolor pachyderms is really too much for me.
I am not the type to faint when things are odd or things are quaint, but seeing things you know that ain't can certainly give you an awful fright. What a sight!
Chase them away! Chase them away! I'm afraid, need your aid, pink elephants on parade!
Part 1, Chapter 12, World War II Revving Up. After the bombing of Pearl Harbor, many of Disney's animators were drafted into the military. On December 8, 1941, the United States Navy asked Walt Disney to create propaganda films to support the war effort. He agreed and signed a contract with the U.S. Navy to produce 20 war-related shorts for $90,000, which would be worth a little under $1.9 million today. Most of the remaining employees would work on the propaganda productions, such as Victory Through Air Power and Der Führer's Face.
Not to love the Fuhrer is a great disgrace. So be hail, right in the Fuhrer's face.
The war would continue to affect the financial performance of the Disney films. The military propaganda films only generated enough revenue to cover costs, and critically acclaimed films such as Bambi would suffer as well, as it was released in August of 1942, right smack in the middle of the war. Sorry, Bambi. Part 1, Chapter 13, Walt's South American Adventures. In 1940, the newly formed CIAA asked prominent members of Hollywood to visit various countries in Latin America and create films with Latin American themes fused into them. The intent was to garner goodwill with the Latin American countries to help suppress the Nazi influence that was spreading across the continents. Unfortunately for the U.S., this move backfired at first, and the Latin American countries had their fill of pompous U.S. ambassadors and snobby Hollywood elitists. The U.S. government once again turned to Walt Disney for help. At first, Walt Disney was reluctant, as this kind of task wasn't his forte. But when they suggested he spend the time researching and gathering inspiration for his films, he changed his tune. It was a difficult time for Walt Disney and his beloved company. Between the World War and the animator strike, threatening to undo everything that he had built. When the CIAA promised to underwrite the trip, removing any financial liabilities that would have concerned Walt, it would be enough incentive for him to make the journey. Walt Disney and his wife, along with 15 Disney employees and one of the other employees' wife, all made the journey to South America. They would call themselves El Grupo Disney, which means the Disney Group in Spanish. Walt arrived in Rio de Janeiro on August 17, 1941. Brazilian parrot native to the region would serve as an inspiration for one of Donald Duck's Latin co-stars, Jose Carioca.
What's that? A parrot?
Cavalheiro, aqui está o meu cartão. Não, senhor. José Carioca, Rio de Janeiro, Brasil.
El Grupo Disney's next destination would be Argentina. After Argentina, El Grupo Disney would break off into four separate groups to explore various locations within South America. These destinations would include other parts of Argentina as well as Bolivia and Peru. They would gather more material until they reunited on September 29, 1941, in Santiago, Chile. On October 4, 1941, they boarded the TES Santa Clara and began their long voyage home. Walt's time spent in Latin America inspired him to create such films as Saludos Amigos and The Three Caballeros. The films were successful and helped foster goodwill between America and many Latin American countries. They also skyrocketed Donald Duck's global popularity.
Muito obrigado. Donald Duck? Pato Donald? Pato Donald? Ora, venha de lá abraço. Mesmo daqueles. Quebra-costelas. Bem carioca. Bem amigo. Seja bem-vindo, meu caro.
Part 1, Chapter 14. A controversial song in the South. At the behest of Roy Disney, the studio started productions of less expensive live-action films with a mixture of animation, such as The Song of the South, to help recuperate financial losses from the war. The film premiered in Atlanta, Georgia, on November 12, 1946. The film was a financial and critical success, with the song Zippity-Doo-Dah winning the 1947 Academy Award for Best Original Song. However, the film is now very controversial, with many critics taking issue with the portrayal of African Americans. Due to its controversy, the film has never been released on DVD in the U.S., nor has it ever been available on Disney Plus in the United States. The cartoon characters from the film are best recognized as the colorful critters that make up the ride Splash Mountain. Located at Disneyland Tokyo, and formerly at the Magic Kingdom and Disneyland California. Say what you want about the film, but Splash Mountain was an awesome ride that I always have fond memories of going on as a kid. And Zippity-Doo-Dah was a banger performed wonderfully by James Baskett.
All right. Out of it, zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay. My, oh my, what a wonderful day. Plenty of sunshine heading my way. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay. Mr. Bluebird's on my shoulder. It's the truth. It's actual. Everything is satisfactual. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay. Wonderful feeling, wonderful day.
Part 1, Chapter 15, A Return to Form. On February 15th, 1950, Cinderella was released. It was Disney's first completely animated feature film in 8 years. This movie was seen as a return to form, and it was Disney's most financially successful film since Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Making $8 million off of a $2.2 million budget in its first year. $8 million would be worth about $100 million today. This was followed up by another successful film run with Disney's first fully live-action feature film, Treasure Island, which released in England on June 22, 1950, and then released in the U.S. on July 29, 1950. Disney was back.
We are back!
That's
we
right.
are back!
Part 1, Chapter 16. Allison, It's a Wonder It Got Made at All Land. Walt has been a fan of Lewis Carroll's Alice stories since he was a schoolboy. He produced a short film loosely inspired by the Alice books when he was at Laugh-O-Gram Studios, which I mentioned way back in the beginning of the video. The Disney brothers would decide to make an Alice in Wonderland movie after the massive success of Snow White. The Disney company started working on Alice in Wonderland way back in 1938, but Walt was displeased with how it was turning out. He was a huge fan of the source material and wanted to do it justice, but at the same time, he was a bit disinterested in the project, as he was more invested in other projects. The company would continue to work on the project, albeit very slowly. Production would stop and start again for one reason or another, and it was seeming like the movie would never see the light of day, but that day would finally come. On July 26, 1951, it would finally release in theaters. And flop.
I won't do it at all!
Part 1, Chapter 17. Welcome to Mickey Mouse Park. Walt was planning on the construction of an amusement park, which he called Mickey Mouse Park. It would be on a site near his studio and would include various attractions such as a steamboat ride. He got an idea for the amusement park during a trip to Griffith Park with his daughters while watching them on the carousel. But his plans for the park were interrupted by other business matters, such as producing the film The Sword and the Rose. Walt changed the amusement park's name from Mickey Mouse Park to Disneylandia, and then he finally settled in Disneyland, a name you're probably very familiar with today. Roy was very doubtful about Walt's park idea. Beginning to sense a trend here with the two brothers. Walt comes up with an elaborate idea, Roy tells him it's not going to work, Walt goes ahead and does it anyway, and then it's wildly successful. Rinse, repeat. Can't blame Roy, someone's got to be the realistic foil to Walt. Due to Roy's concerns, Walt formed a new company titled Walt Disney Enterprises on December 16, 1952 to fund the park. Designers who worked on the park's plans were known as Imagineers. This company's name would change a few times over the years. It's now known as Walt Disney Imagineering. Walt scrapped his plans to build the park on 8 acres near Burbank, as he realized that it wouldn't be nearly enough land. Walt would purchase 160 acres of land in Anaheim, Orange County, California. It would cost $6,200 per acre to build his dream park. The park's construction began on July 12, 1954. Upon the park's completion, it would have cost $17 million to construct, which would have been worth $187 million today. The icon of the park would be Sleeping Beauty's castle, and it would be a clever marketing tactic to promote the upcoming movie Sleeping Beauty, which was still early in development.
I know.
Part 1, Chapter 18. Disney as seen on TV. Disney was getting more involved with television programming as TVs became more common in American households. When Walt Disney sold his Smoke Tree Ranch in Palm Springs, California, the company promoted it with a television series. Disney and ABC would enter a contract to produce an hour-long weekly anthology series starting in October of 1954. It would consist of cartoons, live-action features, and various other works from Disney's library. The show was a success, which opened the door for the Mickey Mouse Club, a variety show for children. Millions of children and adults alike would watch the show. The mouse ears that the children wore on the show were also a huge hit, with 2 million pairs being sold. On December 15, 1954, Disney aired a 5-part miniseries called Davy Crockett. It was an overnight sensation. The coonskin cap that was worn by Davy Crockett was so popular that Disney sold over 10 million Crockett coonskin caps. The sensation would be labeled as the greatest merchandising fad the world has ever seen by Los Angeles Times. The show's theme song would also become ingrained in American pop culture, with over 10 million records being sold.
Born on a mountaintop in Tennessee, green estate in the land of the free, raised in the woods so he knew every tree, killed him a bar when he was only 3. Davy, Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier.
Part 1, Chapter 19, The Happiest Place on Earth. Disneyland would open on July 17, 1955. At that time, there was a total of 20 attractions. Entry to the park only cost $1. However, guests had to pay per ride. The opening was aired on ABC, with actors who were friends with Walt hosting it. The actors included Art Linkletter, Bob Cummings, and Ronald Reagan. Over 90 million people turned in to watch it, making it the most watched live broadcast of all time to that point. However, that's where the good news ends. The opening day would be disastrous and be dubbed Black Sunday by the employees. They prepared to handle 11,000 people, but 28,000 people showed up, because of the sale of counterfeit tickets. Restaurants would run out of food, and it was 100 degrees Fahrenheit out. Drinking fountains weren't working, and multiple rides would malfunction. And on top of all that, the Mark Twain riverboat began to sink. Despite its disastrous opening, the park would go on to be wildly successful. After only a couple years, more people would visit Disneyland than the Yellowstone National Park or even the Grand Canyon. Disney began making double what it was before the park. Although Walt would focus more and more of his attention on the park, the company would continue to produce multiple films per year. Some notable releases in the late 50s were Old Yeller, Sleeping Beauty, and The Shaggy Dog.
Best dog on dog in the West. Here, Yeller, come back, Yeller. Best dog on dog in the West.
Part 1, Chapter 20, The Sherman Brothers. In 1956, Robert and Richard Sherman were asked to produce a theme song for the television series Zorro. The company liked them so much they offered them roles as executive staff songwriters, an arrangement that would last for 10 years. They would go on to write many famous Disney songs, such as Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, Chim Chim Churri, A Spoonful of Sugar, I Want to Be Like You, and It's a Small World. Part 1, Chapter 21, Kid Kurt. Kurt Russell was a child actor for Disney in the 60s. He would feature in films such as The Horse in the Gray Flannel Suit and The Computer Wore Tennis Shoes. I was debating cutting this chapter, as it's nothing more than a mere fun fact, but Kurt Russell is one of my favorite actors, and I didn't know this fact about him before making this video, so I decided to share it with y'all.
Besides, it's my video, and I can include it if I want to.
It's my party, and I'll cry.
Part 1, Chapter 22, Planning the Future. In 1959, Walt Disney had an idea to build another park. He chose to build this park in the area of Orlando, Florida. The company would acquire 27,000 acres of land for it. And to think his original plan for Mickey Mouse Park would have been on 8 acres of land. On November 15th, 1965, Walt and Roy, along with Florida's governor, Hayden Burns, announced the plans for Disney World, which would include plans for the Magic Kingdom, a larger version of Disneyland, and the City of Tomorrow, which would be renamed Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow, a.k.a. Epcot.
Here in Florida, we have something special we never enjoyed at Disneyland, the blessing of size. There's enough land here to hold all the ideas and plans we could possibly imagine. Right now, our plans include an airport of the future down here in Osceola County, an entrance complex where all visitors will enter Disney World, an industrial park area covering about 1,000 acres, and of course, the theme park area way up here. And all these varied activities around the Disney World will be tied together by a high-speed rapid transit system running almost the full length of the property. But the most exciting, by far the most important part of our Florida project, in fact, the heart of everything we'll be doing in Disney World will be our experimental prototype city of tomorrow. We call it Epcot, spelled E-P-C-O-T, Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow.
Part 1, Chapter 23, The Death of Disney. Walt Disney has been a heavy smoker for decades, which is why he was experiencing deteriorating health. He would visit St. Joseph's Hospital on November 2nd, 1966 for testing. The doctors discovered a walnut-sized spot on his left lung and determined it to be cancerous. A few days later, it was removed. After 2 weeks in the hospital, Walt would be released. However, he would never fully recover, and he would die on December 15th, 1966, at the age of 65. The cause of death was circulatory collapse caused by lung cancer from his bad smoking habits. The man who was primarily responsible for the company's creative vision was gone. Part 1, Chapter 24, Walt's Last Hurrah.
The final film that Walt Disney directly worked on was The Jungle Book. The film was released on October 18, 1967. It did far more than make the bare necessities to break even. It would make a profit, a huge profit, and it would be the most successful movie that the Walt Disney Company would make for over two decades. Walt can rest easy knowing that he ended as strong as he started. Snow White and The Jungle Book were two of his finest works, and hopefully he was proud of all he accomplished. Walt Disney will forever be one of the biggest names in the entertainment industry, and many others will strive to emulate his success.
I want to be like you. I want to walk like you. Talk like you. You'll see it's true.
Part 1, Chapter 25, Animation Apathy. Without Walt to lead the way in advancing animation technologies and storytelling, the company would decide to largely abandon animation industry altogether. They cut down their staff from 500 animators to 125, and from 1970 through 1977 would only hire 21 new animators. Even when they did decide to put out an animated film, it wouldn't feel the same as it used to. The first post-Walt Disney animated Disney film was The Aristocats, which premiered on December 11, 1970. And while it was met with generally positive reaction from audiences and critics alike, the film's lack of Walt's creative touch could be felt. Dave Kerr of the Chicago Tribune would write that the absence of Walt's hand in the film was evident.
His kitchen's not the same without you. It's just a greasy spoon.
Just a greasy spoon without you.
Part 1, Chapter 26, Retirement Can Wait. Walt's death left Disney without their leader and creative visionary. Roy Disney was ready to retire, but felt obligated to keep Walt's legacy alive, so he stepped up and took the reins of the company. He would become the first CEO and chairman of the company. To further establish Walt's legacy and remind people of his dreams, he renamed Disney World to Walt Disney World. In May of 1967, Roy had legislation passed in Florida to grant Walt Disney World its own quasi-government agency in an area labeled the Reedy Creek Improvement District. This legislation would remain intact until very recently, as it was stripped away by Governor Ron DeSantis. Part 1, Chapter 27, The Most Magical Place on Earth. It would take 18 months to construct and cost $400 million, but finally on October 1st, 1971, Roy Disney and the rest of the company would celebrate the grand opening of the Magic Kingdom, as well as Disney's Polynesian Resort and Disney's Contemporary Resort. The park would have over 10,000 visitors that would have been greeted with a parade of over 1,000 band members and 4,000 entertainers that marched down Main Street. The icon of the park is Cinderella's castle, which is also the icon I used in my thumbnail for the video. Part 1, Chapter 28, The Disney-less Disney. Shortly after the grand opening of the Magic Kingdom, Disney would be dealt another blow, as they would lose their final co-founder on December 21, 1971. Roy died of a stroke caused by a cerebral hemorrhage at the age of 78 in St. Joseph's Hospital, Burbank, California, the same hospital Walt died at 5 days and 5 years earlier. Disney's leadership was now Disney-less. Don Tatum, a senior executive and former president, would become the first non-Disney to become CEO and chairman of the company. Card Walker, who had been with the company since 1938, would become the new president. The first animated film post both Disney brothers was Robin Hood, which would be a hit overseas and became Disney's highest-grossing international box office performance up to that point.
Robin Hood and Little John walking through the forest, laughing back and forth at what the other has to say. Reminiscing this and that and having such a good time. Oodle-lolly, oodle-lolly, golly, what a day. Never ever thinking there was danger in the water they were drinking, they just guzzled it down. Never dreaming that a scheming sheriff and his posse was watching them and gathering around. Robin Hood and Little John running through the forest, jumping fences, dodging trees, and trying to get away. Contemplating nothing but escaping, finally making it. Oodle-lolly, oodle-lolly, golly, what a day. Oodle-lolly, oodle-lolly, golly, what a day.
Card Walker would eventually become the CEO of the company, with Tatum remaining the chairman until 1980, when Walker would replace him. While Disney lost both its co-founders by 1971, it wasn't until 1977 that Disney would become truly Disneyless, as Roy Disney's son Roy would resign from his executive position with the company over disagreements with how the company was being run. This would be the start of an on and off again relationship between Walt's nephew and the company. As he would repeatedly resign and rejoin as leadership of the company fluctuated, Roy Edward Disney would die of stomach cancer on December 16, 2009. Part 1, Chapter 29, Disney Goes PG. In 1979, Disney would release their first PG movie, The Black Hole. It would also be their most expensive movie to date, costing them $26 million, which would be approximately $107 million today. The Black Hole was made due to the immense popularity of the sci-fi genre at the time. The film would be a disappointment to Disney, as it only grossed $35 million. They were hoping it would be a major hit like Star Wars. Well, if you can't beat them, buy them, right, Disney? What could possibly go wrong?
I got a bad feeling about this.
Part 1, Chapter 30, The City of Tomorrow. October 1st, 1982, as company profits were starting to decline, Epcot, the second part in Walt Disney World, had its grand opening. It would cost $900 million to construct, which would be worth about $2.7 billion today. Epcot consisted of two main sections, Future World, which is what the plans for the City of Tomorrow would turn into, and the World Showcase, which featured Mexico, China, Germany, Italy, America, Japan, France, United Kingdom, and Canada. Morocco and Norway would be added later. The icon of Epcot is Spaceship Earth, which I always thought was a giant golf ball as a kid. Part 1, Chapter 31, Going Global. April 15, 1983, Disney's first park outside the United States was opened in Japan. Tokyo Disneyland would cost $1.4 billion to construct, which would be worth about $5.6 billion today. Over its first 10 years, it would have over 140 million visitors.
Whoa, that's a lot of people.
Part 1, Chapter 32, Pay to Lose. On April 18th, 1983, Disney would make a $100 million investment into a pay-to-watch cable television channel called The Disney Channel. It was a 16 hours a day service. The channel was expected to do well, but it ended up losing $48.3 million in its first year.
Aww.
Part 1, Chapter 33, A More Mature Disney. 1983, Walt's son-in-law, Ron Miller, who had been president since 1978, became the CEO. Miller wanted the studio to produce more mature content for a more mature audience. Under Miller's leadership, Disney would create the film distribution label Touchstone Pictures in 1984. When asked why Miller created Touchstone, Miller responded the following statement. One day, Walt called and said, "I've got a film I'm running tonight. Why don't you come over?" So Diane and I, we went over there. The film was To Kill a Mockingbird. When it was over, Walt said, "Damn, I wish I could make a film like that," but he couldn't. Miller wanted to take the company in new directions that Walt wouldn't have been able to. Splash would be the first release under the Touchstone label, and it was released on March 9, 1984, and would be a much-needed success for the company. Disney would release its first R-rated movie, Down and Out in Beverly Hills, in 1986, and the following year release its first PG film, Adventures in Babysitting. Both would be successful releases.
Good job!
Part 1, Chapter 34, Enter Michael Eisner. On September 22, 1984, Disney shareholders would oust CEO Ron Miller and replace him with Michael Eisner, who was the former president of Paramount Pictures. They would also appoint Frank Wells as president. Eisner's first goal as CEO was to make Disney a major film studio again, which it hasn't been since Walt's death. Eisner wanted to bring animation back to the forefront of the company. He would appoint Roy E. Disney as the head of the animation division. Instead of making anime films every 4 years, as they have been at the time, he would have the company produce one every 18 months.
Good job!
Part 1, Chapter 35, The Empty Cauldron. The Black Cauldron, which released on July 24, 1985, would be the most expensive animated movie ever made up to that point, costing $40 million, which would be worth $120 million today. Unfortunately, it would be a massive flop. only earning back half its budget. Part 1, Chapter 36, Another Name Change. 1986, the company changed its name from Walt Disney Productions to the Walt Disney Company. They made the name change because they said the old name referred only to the film industry. Unlike John Proctor, Disney can have another name.
Because it is my name! Because I cannot have another in my life!
Part 1, Chapter 37, European Vacation. Speaking about being more than just a film company, in 1987, the Walt Disney Company would sign an agreement with the government of France to build the resort Euro Disneyland in Paris. The resort would consist of two theme parks, Disneyland Paris and Walt Disney Studios Park, as well as a golf course and six hotels. If you plan on visiting Europe, hopefully your trip goes better than Clark Griswold's did.
I guess what we do is just drive around this circle here. It should be the second left exit. There's the hotel. Hey, look, kids! There's Big Ben and there's Parliament!
There it is.
I know. I can't seem to get over to the left, honey. I'll try next time. Sorry. We'll get out of this jam in a minute. Kids, Big Ben, Parliament again. Kids.
We know, Big Ben.
Parliament. Look, kids. Forget it. It's amazing. I cannot get left. There's Big Ben, kids. Parliament.
Part 1, Chapter 38, Hollywood Heavy Hitters. In 1988, Disney became the box office leading studio for their first time due to the massive hits Who Framed Roger Rabbit? And Oliver and Company. In Oliver and Company, the Artful Dodger was voiced by my favorite musician, Billy Joel.
I'm street smart. I got New York City heart. Why should I worry? Why should I care? I may not have a dime, but I got streets out my bed.
Part 1, Chapter 39, The Park with Multiple Names and Faces. Also in 1989, Disney would open its third park in Walt Disney World. This park would be film-themed and would be named Disney MGM Studios, now called Hollywood Studios. What sets this park apart from other parks besides being movie-themed is that it has four icons. This park has a bit of an identity crisis. While every other park has one clear icon, with Sleeping Beauty's castle for Disneyland, Cinderella's castle for Magic Kingdom, Spaceship Earth for Epcot, and the Tree of Life for Animal Kingdom, which I'll cover that park shortly, but Hollywood Studios can't seem to make up its mind about what the face of the park is. The four icons are the Chinese Theater, the Tower of Terror, the Magic Mickey Hat, and the Earful Tower. That's a lot of icons. What's the definitive icon for the park? I don't know. Dealer's choice, I guess. Part 1, Chapter 40, A Muppet Mishap. In 1989, Disney wanted to acquire the Jim Henson Company from the founder, Jim Henson himself. The deal included all the Muppet characters, excluding the ones designed for Sesame Street. Unfortunately, however, Henson died before the deal was completed, and the merger between the two companies was terminated. Disney would have to wait until 2004 to finally purchase the Muppets franchise.
Always running out of time.
And I don't care what anybody says.
Now I understand who I am.
I believe in you.
I'm a man.
Part 1, Chapter 41, The Disney Renaissance. Disney hasn't been the company it once was following Walt and Roy's deaths. However, that was starting to change in the late 80s, and it would be solidified by a film that would be dubbed the beginning of the Disney Renaissance. That film was The Little Mermaid, which released on November 17, 1989. It would earn over $230 million at the box office, off of a budget of $40 million. The film would earn two Academy Awards, Best Original Score and Best Original Song, for Under the Sea.
World, it's a mess. Life under the sea is better than anything they got up there. The seaweed is always greener in somebody else's lake. You dream about going up there, but that is a big mistake. Just look at the world around you, right here on the ocean floor. Such wonderful things around you. What more are you looking for? Under the sea, under the sea. Darling, it's better down where it's wetter. Take it from me. Up on the shore, they work all day. Out in the sun, they slave away. While they're devoting full time, you're floating under the sea.
The Disney Renaissance would return that magical feeling to the Disney company that was felt when the Disney brothers were alive. During this era, the company would release several hugely successful and critically acclaimed films. Disney was back, and some would argue, better than ever. Other mega hits that would release during this era would include Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Pocahontas, The Hunchback of Notre Dame, Hercules, Mulan, and Tarzan. But one animated film would rise above all the others and truly reign supreme at the box office.
One ring to rule them all. One ring to find them. One ring to bring them all, and in the darkness, find them.
Part 1, Chapter 42, King of the Box Office. The Lion King released on June 24, 1994, and would completely dominate the box office, becoming the second highest grossing movie of all time to that point, only behind Jurassic Park, and would be the highest grossing anime movie of all time up to that point as well. It was off a budget of $45 million, and it made just shy of $1 billion at the box office. Whew, that's impressive. In my opinion, it has one of the greatest song tracks of all time. It is insane to me that The Circle of Life, I Just Can't Wait to Be King, Be Prepared, Hakuna Matata, and Can You Feel the Love Tonight all came from one movie. The Lion King deserves all the praise and success that it has garnered over the years. In my opinion, it is the best Disney movie of all time. I think it's one of the best movies ever made, period.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Hakuna Matata. Ain't no peasant craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days.
It's our problem-free.
Part 1, Chapter 43, The World's Largest Theme Park. The final park to join Walt Disney World would be the Animal Kingdom. It would open on Earth Day, April 22, 1998. It would be the largest theme park in the world, covering 580 acres of land. It had 6 animal theme lands, over 2,000 live animals, and the park's icon, the Tree of Life, at the center. This park is dedicated to environmental and animal conservation, a company philosophy pioneered by Walt Disney himself. It is the second most popular park at Walt Disney World behind the Magic Kingdom. The Animal Kingdom is the third most visited theme park in America and the sixth most visited theme park in the world. It is also the most visited zoo in the world. It's my second favorite park after Epcot, and the newly added Pandora section is just incredible. Part 1, Chapter 44, The End of an Era. All good things come to an end, and it was the end of an era, as the Disney Renaissance would come to a close with the release of Tarzan. The film released on June 12, 1999. It would make $448 million off a $130 million budget. It was critically acclaimed, winning an Academy Award for Best Original Song for Phil Collins' You'll Be in My Heart. The whole soundtrack was amazing, as Phil Collins is a musical genius.
Thank you.
Part 1 Epilogue. So, that was my speedrun through the history of the Walt Disney Company up till the modern millennia. From its humble beginnings making Alice shorts in 1923, to its first hits with Mickey Mouse and Snow White, to Walt's last hurrah of The Jungle Book, to his explosive comeback during the Disney Renaissance in the 90s, and everything else in between. The 20th century Walt Disney Company had its ups and downs for sure, but what set it apart from the modern era of Disney was its focus on innovation and originality. That's not to say that the modern era of Disney is necessarily inferior to the previous eras, but rather it's run differently, and that different style would work really well. Until it didn't. So what we just covered was the BBI section of Disney's history, BBI standing for Before Bob Iger. We'll be moving into the DBI section in a follow-up video, before ending with the ABI section in the same video. DBI and ABI standing for During Bob Iger and After Bob Iger. Disney's centenary was not the grand celebration the company was hoping for, as they lost money hand over fist this year. I wish I could have gotten the whole video out on time, but alas, life tends to get in the way. I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and that this video will help you better understand and enjoy the next video, as the two were supposed to be one big mega video. Hopefully it eventually comes out. If you enjoyed the video, please give it a like, and if you're interested in watching the second half of this video, subscribe to my channel so you can catch it and any of my other videos when they release. This is Iron Mandrill, signing off. Have yourselves a happy new year.
Now's the time for us to say, Happy New Year, Happy New Year.
Catch y'all in 2024. Ciao.